championship in the world in just 6 months.
That's right. Gotta buy me a house. Gotta make a lot of money. A lot of money. Then we're gonna go traveling, me and my kid, right?
Right.
All over the world. Where are we gonna go?
Brazil.
Brazil. What are we gonna see in Brazil? I know what we're gonna see. A lot of senoritas dancing the cha-cha-cha. Right?
Right.
Dancing the cha-cha-cha-cha-cha.
Cha-cha-cha.
A joyful moment from the champ with John Voight as a has-been prize fighter back in training and little Ricky Schroeder as his adoring 8-year-old son. The champ is just one of 5 new movies we'll be looking at on Sneak Previews, 2 film critics reviewing the new movies in town. Across the aisle from me is Gene Siskel, the film critic of the Chicago Tribune and CBS TV News in Chicago.
And this is Roger Ebert, the Pulitzer Prize-winning film critic of the Chicago Sun-Times. Now, in addition to the champ's sentimental melodrama, we'll be reviewing the suspense of Murder by Decree, a new Sherlock Holmes story. Also, the romance and comedy of A Perfect Couple, Robert Altman's new film. Also, the adventure and comedy of Buck Rogers in the 25th century. But now Rogers starts with a film that, to my mind, is one of the finest musical pictures ever made, Hair.
I liked it too.
Great.
The stage version of Hair was one of the most successful musicals of the 1960s, but I would have guessed that somehow to be hopelessly dated by now. A relic of the age of Aquarius, along with hippies and flower power and love beads. Remember love beads? I would have guessed wrong. The new film version by Milos Forman takes the strings of the original musical, including a lot of great songs, and combines them with a contemporary, fresh approach, as in this scene of a classic generation gap, where a hippie, played by Treat Williams, invades high society.
I'll tell you something. If you want me out of here, you're going to have to throw me out.
That's exactly what I'm going to do, Mr. Berger. I'm going to get the police. I'm not going to muss myself up fussing around with you. I'm going to get the police and get you out of here if I have to.
Okay.
That's exactly what I'm going to do.
Okay. Penguin?
You've got a hell of a nerve, young man.
I got life, mother. I got life's sister. I got freedom, brother. And I got good times, man. I got crazy ways, daughter. I got million-dollar charm, cousin. I got headaches and toothaches and bad times too, like you. I got more hair, I got more head, I got more brains, I got more ears, I got my eyes, I got my nose, I got my mouth, I got my teeth, I got my tongue, I got my chin, I got my neck.
When he's not dancing on tabletops, Treat Williams looks for confrontations with the establishment. After a friend of his is drafted, for example, he drives all the way out west to try to visit him during basic training.
Hi.
How are you doing? What can I do for you?
We're going in.
I'm sorry, but there's no civilian contact allowed on the base right now. We've got an alert.
Well, we're not civilians. We're friends of a guy on the base. His name's Claude Bukowski. You probably know him. He's a private.
No, I don't know any
really
Claude
nice
Bukowski.
Guy. He's got blonde hair, short.
No, I don't know any
short.
Claude Bukowski, but I'm sorry. You're still going to have to turn your vehicle around and go off post. All right. If you need some help, I'll be glad to assist you. Otherwise, back your vehicle up and turn it around.
Well, listen, we don't want to make any trouble. You
turn
don't understand.
Around, you won't. Okay.
Okay, just let me make a phone call.
No, you don't make a phone call here. You want to make a phone call, you make a phone call back where I tell you to go.
You just said to me you wanted to give me some assistance. Now, I just would like to
get in touch
with
you. Yeah, I'm going to help you turn around. That's only I want to help you do.
Yeah, well, you don't understand. I mean,
Hey, Chief, this is it right here. You're going to have to turn the vehicle around and go. We clear? You get my drift, right? Turn your vehicle around and go off post.
Listen,
right?
You don't understand, man. We've just driven for about 5 days straight,
listen,
man.
Listen, my
I
man.
I just want to see my friend for a couple hours,
hey,
all
listen,
right?
I'm telling you to get the hell off my post. You turn your vehicle around and go that way. That's what I'm telling you. You listen to me. I'm not listening to you. You got that? Thank you. Have a nice day.
That scene is just a perfect distillation of the way American society was polarized during the Vietnam era, and in fact, one of the best things about this completely alive and successful movie version of Hair is that it captures so exactly some of the feelings of America in the 1960s. It's a musical, yes, with all the great hits we remember, like The Age of Aquarius, Good Morning Starshine, but it's also an accurate memory of what things were like 10 or 12 years ago. And it's like West Side Story or Cabaret in this, that it manages to be serious and joyous at the same time. It's a good movie.
I think it's better than that. I think it's great. And what I love about it is most movie musicals, as soon as somebody starts to sing, the action really stops. Here, they blend in beautifully. We saw it. That woman says to him, "You got a lot of nerve," and he responds, "I got life." It fits beautifully. A nice screenplay. Very well done.
I think you're right. One thing that's interesting about it, directed by a man named Milos Forman, who's from Czechoslovakia. His previous big movie in this country is One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest.
Academy Award winner. Yeah.
A lot of Academy Awards. In both of these films, he shows a real feeling for American society, even though he's in exile, you know? And I was thinking, maybe it's because both of these films are about exiles within American society, people who don't really fit and who feel left out.
Both films are also about freedom, if you want. Nicholson trying to get out of that hospital, and these kids trying to be free, America trying to free itself of some really tough conflicts. I think this film is so darn good because it's actually like a documentary. If you were writing a newspaper story on what America was like in the conflicts, you'd use quotes like that from that MP, who actually is played by a real MP, not an actor. Oh, it's awfully good. I recommend this film as highly as anything we've got on the show.
Two immediate yeses, right?
Absolutely. Okay. Now, our next movie is not in the same league. It's Murder by Decree, yet another Sherlock Holmes film. Why so many Sherlock Holmes films? Well, as the cost of making films gets higher and higher, film companies seem to be playing it safer and safer with remakes, sequels, tried and true subjects like Sherlock Holmes and Dracula, films that don't take many risks, films that don't take any risks. Murder by Decree is a quite violent film. In fact, it's so bloody, I think it should really be rated R instead of PG. In that picture, Christopher Plummer plays Sherlock Holmes. Late in the film, he confronts England's Prime Minister, played by John Gielgud, with evidence that a series of killings of low-rent prostitutes leads right up to the throne of England for its prime suspect.
You accuse, but it is proof we need, Mr. Holmes. You've heard this tragic story now, but what is your link with Annie Crook? Where is your proof?
You have no proof, only surmise, wild conjecture.
I have proof. I have proof that a woman was cynically taken in marriage. I have proof of the husband's name, that a child was born. I have proof that the woman was committed to an asylum by order of that same Spivey. I have proof of evidence suppressed by you, Sir Charles. Evidence which seemed to accuse a member of the sacred order to which you all belonged.
What should I tell the Queen? You surely don't suggest that Her Majesty is in any way involved.
I cannot easily believe that.
You have my word.
I would prefer some more reliable authority.
In the circumstances, I shall ignore your offensive attitude.
If I seem to be offensive, Prime Minister, you may take it I am offended. You offend me.
Shall I resign? Would that satisfy you?
Yes, resign.
And there we see really the film's biggest problem. At a crucial point, its ending, Murder by Decree, is much too talky. That speech goes on for at least another 5 minutes. It ends up ruining what could have been a fine picture. Does have some good performances. Christopher Plummer is a good Holmes. James Mason is excellent as Dr. Watson. But the film's long, talky passages really obliterate all the thrills.
You know, Gene, you're right. I was thinking there can't have ever been that many thrillers that suddenly, at the end of an hour and a half of action and so forth, stabbings and burnings, and you're right, it's very violent, suddenly we get, you said 5 minutes, I'd say at least 10 minutes of inexplicable dialogue. They recapitulate what happens. Holmes speculates about the meaning of it all. It's not elementary at all this time to Holmes. The audience sits there, they're stunned. It's going on and on. What did they do, tune into a radio play?
Yeah, well, you've devastated this picture. I'm amazed, I guess, that it does build up like that and then really come to a halt. Do you think it should have been R-rated? I did.
Perhaps so. Yeah, it's a pretty bloody picture for a PG. It's not a family Sherlock Holmes movie.
Yeah, I would not take my kids to the film. And in fact, I wish I didn't have to go myself.
Well, I'm sorry, but you did.
Yeah.
All for the good of the show. Mm-hmm. Our next movie is A Perfect Couple by Robert Altman, a filmmaker who never seems to repeat himself. He's always starting off in one new direction after another, but his new movie is so offbeat that maybe even Altman himself didn't know quite where he was headed. Perfect Couple is about a gloriously imperfect couple who are matched up by one of those videotape computer dating companies. The girl is played by Marta Heflin. The guy is played by Paul Dooley. And so there he is standing in her apartment, an unexpected guest, because she's made a date with another guy sent over by the same computer.
Hi!
Who's this?
Hi! Am I early?
Oh, it's my date. No, you're right on the dot.
Here you go.
Oh, now you got two of them. I see you saw the same kid with the flowers on the corner.
Yeah, the little kid. Yeah, I saw him. Yeah.
Alex 207, this is Dana 115.
Pleased to meet you, sir.
I'm almost ready. Where are we going?
We're
going
to go to this terrific little Greek restaurant I know in Venice.
Venice? California. Damn it, that's my restaurant.
What do you mean, your restaurant? I mean, what is it?
Yeah, he's just leaving, aren't you?
Okay.
No, you're just leaving. Right this way, sir.
No, wait a minute. We are going out, right?
Excuse me, sir. This young lady and
not
I have
sir,
a date.
No, it's Dana.
I don't care. I'm going to take her out tonight.
Well, no, we have a date tonight.
I think you'll find the elevators a lot quicker if you go
no,
there.
No, wait a minute. No, wait. Now, we have a date tonight. We are going out.
You don't understand. We've been going together for quite a while now. She
no, I understand. We are going
she
out.
She probably lied to you, too, because we have a date.
She didn't lie to me, and we're going to...
You're not wanted there. Right this happens to be my evening with
now,
this
wait
lady.
A minute. No, I have a date with her. We are going out.
Sir, will you please go to the elevator and leave?
Don't call me sir, it's Dana, and don't pull me around.
Well, how about a push then?
Do not push me. Don't ever push me. Don't touch me. Don't push me.
I'll push you if I want to push
no,
you.
No, don't push me. Do not push me. I'll push you
no,
back.
No, please.
I will push you back.
Push you?
Please. Because if I get mad, I will hit.
Well, I'll push too, you know.
I'm getting very angry.
Now you're pushing me.
Yes, and I'll push you again.
If I can't push you, how come
I'll
you...
push you
again. I will push you. Oh,
I'm getting mad.
Don't. You, I'm going to hit you real soon.
Okay, so what do we learn about the computer? It looks like the girl ordered mustaches, blue men's suits, and yellow roses, right. And so far so good. But then it turns out she has nothing else in common with the guy that she's been matched up with. Now, Paul Dooley plays a member of a very, very strange Greek-American family. It's headed by a father who totally intimidates his middle-aged children. Marty Heflin, on the other hand, comes from an extended family that's half rock band and half commune. And you could sort of say these two people were not exactly made for each other. They share almost nothing except the ability to get each other into the most appalling situations.
I'll never forgive myself. I don't even remember what happened.
This didn't look like a car door. It looks more like a poker or something.
Ouch!
God, you're so brave. I usually faint at the sight of blood.
My ex-wife used to do that.
Most of these things are a result of domestic quarrels.
That's right. You were married before. I forgot.
Well, we were only married 12 years, but she had these fainting spells, and she spent most of her time in bed. I really didn't see that much of her.
What happened?
A jazz musician ran away with a saxophone player.
My wife plays the saxophone. She plays classical music. Gives her something to do.
You know, his sister's with the L.A. Philharmonic. She plays the cello.
Oh, I didn't mean she was with an orchestra. I mean she plays to records.
Yeah, my father does that. Only he conducts. Ow.
Probably ought to stay in bed for a while. Do you want some painkillers?
Yes.
No.
Some doctors don't like to give out too many painkillers, but when you've seen as much pain as I have, it makes you want to kill it. I don't think you two should be kissing while I'm suturing.
I'm sorry.
Why'd you meet a saxophone player if she was in bed all the time?
Some nice, wry, understated dialogue there. It's a funny scene. The first scene was funny, too, and in fact, there's a lot of funny stuff in this movie, but one of the problems with The Perfect Couple is that Altman combines this offbeat romantic comedy with a lot of musical footage featuring a rock band called Keeping Him Off the Streets, and he never seems quite sure in his own mind whether his movie is about the band or about the two star-crossed lovers. I'm afraid that's what keeps the movie from working. It's an interesting film. It has good performances. Has more than a share of comic inspiration, but it just never quite pulls itself together.
I agree with you. I've got two points to make. One, I really liked the couple.
I did too.
Yeah, I found both of them interesting as individuals, and certainly as a couple. I wanted them to get together. I was rooting for them. But then, as you mentioned, it falls apart at the end. Now, Robert Altman's had a lot of problems with ending his pictures, but usually it's like the last 5 minutes maybe of Nashville. He had trouble there. Here, it's 45 minutes. The picture really falls off in the second half.
Yeah, you start out with these two interesting people, well-performed, in these bizarre situations, the guy's home life with this crazy father that he has and so forth. Just when you get involved, suddenly you're looking at concert footage of this band. Mm-hmm. It's good enough music, but you keep saying, what are we doing looking at the band for? What happened to the people? Let's have more about them.
I think it's sloppily made, and the reason may be that I think Robert Altman may be making too many films too quickly. He's one of our most gifted filmmakers, Nashville, McCabe and Mrs. Miller, MASH, Brewster McLeod, I like too. He's made 14 films in 9 or 10 years. I think he's making them too quickly. This one he whipped out right after Quintet. I don't think he put enough care into the picture, and I think it shows.
Yeah, but it's kind of funny. Now, I don't think either one of us can quite recommend it, and yet I'd say it's worth taking a chance on if you like Altman. Even
for the
so.
First hour, maybe, at least for me. Now, our next film is another example, like Murder by Decree, that Sherlock Holmes film earlier, of a film company taking fewer and fewer chances. It's MGM's The Champ, a remake of the old 1931 Wallace Beery film. You probably know the story. Can a down-and-out boxer, once a champ, put his life back together again, regain his self-respect, and fulfill the faith of his young son? John Voight plays the fighter, an alcoholic, and a chronic gambler. Everybody's got at least two problems in this picture. Faye Dunaway is his ex-wife, who divorced him when he hit the skids. Now, at a racetrack barn where Voight is working as a stable boy, Dunaway tells Voight that she now wants to take custody of their son, whom she abandoned as an infant. Now, you would think that would be enough emotion for one scene. But as if all of their human problems weren't enough, the script really lays it on thick. The kid's brand new horse has just been injured in a race.
What are you doing here?
How's the horse? Is the horse all right?
The horse is just fine. 5 minutes, they'll probably shoot.
Stop it!
Stop it!
It doesn't work anymore, Billy.
What do you mean it doesn't work anymore?
It doesn't work any...
Like old times, honey. What are you doing here now? No smoking in the barn area. What do you want?
TJ's Timmy, isn't it?
Yeah, TJ is Timmy. So you figured it out, so what? Even a dumb horse knows her own foal.
Don't you think one of us ought to be with him right now? If he's out there...
One of us... One of us is... One of us was for 7 years.
Billy!
He dropped it first.
Billy, will you stop it, please?
What do you want to do? After Billy. 7 years, you want to come back. What do you want to do? Hold his hand? You know what I told him? I told him that you died, that you were killed in a car wreck. That you were a tramp, that we were better off without you. You're dead, you understand that? You're dead. Kid's got no more.
I am his mother.
You're dead. He's got no mother.
I'm here. I am his mother.
You gave me custody, didn't you? And you got what you wanted. Now get the hell out of here.
Please. I'd just like to see him. I'd like to know what he's like. Is that something?
You want to know what he's like? Take a look. He's the one in a million kid you dream about. That's what he's like. You ain't never going to see him. Not now, not never. Come on, let's get out.
Hold on. There's more. Voight's plummeting career sinks even lower when he's arrested for punching out his bookie's muscle men. The kid comes to visit Voight in jail, and Voight tells his son he wants him to start living with Faye Dunaway. Again, another heavy emotional scene.
How you doing, champ?
Sit
down. I thought you might be hungry. I brought you something to eat. Brought you some ribs.
I ain't hungry.
Okay, champ.
I don't want you to call me champ no more.
Why?
A champ don't use his fist nowhere but in the ring.
But he was trying to take a horse, champ.
I know, but don't make no difference, TJ. I had no right, see? I'm a bum.
No, you're not. Did they say when he could get out? Did they say when he could come home?
They don't know yet, TJ. Could be a month. Be 6 months. Look, there's something we gotta talk about. You know that lady? The one at the boat, the one you're going on about how nice she is all the time?
Annie?
Yeah, that's the one, Annie. Well, I want you to do me a favor. I want you to live with her.
That kid sure blinks a lot, but that's as far as I'm going to knock his performance. That scene does drag on awfully a lot, like so many of the scenes in the movie, where the kid is reduced to walking around, crying in his sweet little voice. Oh, champ. That's what he calls his dad, champ. Oh, champ. Come on, champ. You can do it, champ. Too much. Also, I didn't believe John Voight in this role. Most of his emotions were laid on much too thick. In fact, the whole film is really drenched in sobs and sentimentality. But my biggest objection is the same one we had a couple of months ago when Roger and I both knocked the making of a new version of Invasion of the Body Snatchers. And the objection is this. Why? Why remake The Champ? Do we really need another movie version of The Champ? You know, it isn't Hamlet. Worst of all, why waste a year out of the lives of two of our finest actors, Faye Dunaway, John Voight? Why?
I guess you could say we don't need a new version or an old version of a lot of movies, but I think people are going to movies like this now. I liked it. It's old-fashioned, it's melodramatic, it's romantic, it's a tearjerker. You can see the wheels going around, it's a machine to make you cry.
Now, wait a minute.
Okay.
You say it's a machine to make you cry. That means you're aware of something being done to you. And this is where we differ.
Okay.
Because as soon as I get the feeling that a movie is doing something to me, my back goes up. You liked it. Why? Why the difference?
I like the plot mechanism. I felt the old-fashioned obviousness of it was part of the appeal. A handsome guy, his poor little kid, his beautiful wife, the rich man on the ship, all the tears, the horse going, you know, everything, the big fight at the end when they're, you know, the prize fight, everything was such a cliche that I kind of relished it.
Yeah, and I just, you know, the ones that have the cliches that work for me are when I don't recognize it. Star Wars, Rocky, lots of cliches, but they're so good at it and convincing. Here, I'm watching that kid blinking. I'm seeing John Voight and I don't buy it at all.
Well, I don't go so far as to say that I think the movie is a masterpiece,
okay,
but I do think I can recommend it. I think in its old, old-fashioned way, it has kind of a sunniness and a charm to it that appealed to me.
What do you think about what I mentioned before, about Voight and Dunaway in a picture like this?
I think they could certainly both be in better pictures, but on the other hand, they have been in better pictures, they will be in better pictures.
Well, that's optimistic. Now, you go ahead with
our
next
film. Okay. Our next movie, you're talking about movies that are remakes, even worse, is a ripoff. I wasn't surprised to see Buck Rogers come along for that reason, especially not after Star Wars broke every box office record in sight. Because one thing's inevitable about an enormous hit movie like Star Wars, and that is we know it's going to inspire countless imitations and satires and ripoffs. And I guess you could say there's a little bit of all of those things in this new movie called Buck Rogers in the 25th Century. It's based on the old comic strip about an astronaut who's catapulted into the future through our old friend the Time Warp. Those are always dependable, you know? And the future, for some reason, looks a lot like the past, with beautiful damsels in distress, sinister villains, cliff-hanging adventures. Here's one of the movie's dogfights in space. It's a direct ripoff of Star Wars. Not exactly the greatest special effects in the world. Have you sort of noticed that the spaceships or the people in them never move? Anyway, Buck Rogers single-handedly wins this battle and then pays a visit to the enemy's starship.
Welcome aboard the flagship Draconia.
Delighted. This is an unexpected pleasure.
I'm Colonel Deering, commander of the Third Force of the Earth Directorate, and I believe you already know Captain Rogers.
I don't believe we've had the pleasure.
I think you're mistaken, Princess. I never forget a knuckle.
This movie started out as a made-for-TV film, and it really doesn't hold up on the big screen. The movie tries to get away with its cheap production by throwing in a lot of camp humor, but the jokes wear pretty thin after the first, about 5 minutes. And the special effects wear so thin you can almost see through them at times.
Yeah, I didn't like it either, but my biggest objection is this film is a real manipulation here. This is obvious. The picture doesn't end. In the way we expect it. The villains aren't vanquished, and the only reason they did that, they wanted to leave it room for a sequel. So this is the problem. They're trying to make another film, not the one at hand, and the audience really gets shafted in this picture.
Hold on a minute, Gene. I think we have a guest in the balcony, and I think it might be Spot the Wonder Dog. Hello, Spot. Here to introduce the dogs of the week. That's as if Buck Rogers wasn't enough of a dog for this week. Anyway, I guess this time we have a neck-and-neck race. Is that right?
Yes, two Dracula pictures. Some people have complained that they're sick and tired of us picking so often on kung fu films as our dog of the week. Well, this week, thanks to George Hamilton and Susan St. James and an awful script, my dog is Love at First Bite, a toothless Dracula comedy. George Hamilton as Dracula simply doesn't know how to play comedy. You don't make fun of a comic character. It's much funnier if you play him straight. Not George Hamilton when he romances a woman in a contemporary disco.
Look into my eyes and tell me what you see.
They're bloodshot, and you had too much to drink last night.
What else?
I don't know. You tell me.
Love. I love you, and I can give you eternal life.
That says it all, a very unfunny film. If I hadn't been reviewing Love at First Bite, I would have left the theater at first glance.
On the other hand, Gene, what if you really wanted to sink your teeth into the vampire legends? Mm-hmm. I can't think of a worse movie to see than a new pseudo-scientific, pseudo-historic, pseudo-serious, would-be documentary named In Search of Dracula. The movie goes in search of the Dracula legend with lots of shots of castles in Romania and sinister graveyards in the Black Forest, all narrated by veteran vampire Christopher Lee, who makes a list of the things that can kill off vampires. Things like silver crosses and stakes through the heart and garlic and mirrors and innocent virgins and thorns of rose bushes. But he forgot one thing that can also kill off vampires, and that's this movie.
I bet you. And now to recap the main movies on this show, both Roger and I can't praise enough the movie version of the musical Hair. We give it our highest recommendation. The yeses next to our names mean, yes, we recommend you see this picture, which is rated PG. Roger and I also agree that Murder by Decree, the Sherlock Holmes film, is much too talky when it should be thrilling. Two no's for that. We can't recommend you see it. And two reluctant no's for The Love Story of Perfect Couple, a film that doesn't know where to go after its first hour. Roger and I disagree on the remake of The Tearjerker, The Champ. Roger says he likes it. I say no, I felt manipulated. Finally, we both agree that Buck Rogers in the 25th century is a poor imitation of Star Wars. Two loud no's for that.
And that's it for this show, but next on Sneak Previews, we'll review The Bell Jar with Marilyn Hassett as a suicidal young writer, the multi-million-dollar disaster epic Hurricane with Mia Farrow, and Dreamer, a love story, believe it or not, that's set in a bowling alley. Until then, see you at the movies.
Funding for this program is provided by this station and by other public television stations.